Welcome to the podcast with Robby and Cindy that doesn't have a name yet. Thank you for the suggestions. It's Friday, March 18th, 2016, and it's 5:08 p.m. And today's topic is worry. And more specifically, is there any utility in worrying? Go.
Okay. Well, I have always held the belief that there was no purpose in worrying. That, let me rephrase that. In the past, I've always thought there's no purpose in worrying. It's sort of like...
Porpoise.
Porpoise. Did I say porpoise?
It sounded like it.
It's cold out here. That it's sort of like rocking in a chair. It gives you something to do, but it doesn't really accomplish much. It doesn't get you anywhere.
Mm.
But having done a little more research, as I've been doing research on other topics, I didn't research worrying, but I did come across an article last week that said there is a little bit of a purpose to worrying. First of all, when people worry, it lights up a certain part of their brain, which is part of the reward center, and it gives you a place for your anxiety and your motivation to get mixed up and move you forward. The difficulty is that if you stay in that place too long, then you are just in a rocking chair and you're not doing anything. So to get you to move forward towards solving a problem or reaching a goal or whatever, then worrying is fine, but only for short bouts, at least according to that article. And I find for myself that's probably true, that when I don't worry about something at all, things can slip through the cracks or things happen that had I even given it a second thought at all, I would have possibly thought about those things and taken care of them ahead of time. So,
do you worry?
Boy, not very much.
Because I think you're like one of the few human beings on the planet who could stand to worry more.
Yeah, yeah, I could worry more. In fact, that's probably should be a goal for me, is to try to figure out how to worry more. But I am pretty good at very quickly going, can I do anything about this? Like, let's say when you were younger, or even now, you know, lots of people tell me I'm not a good mother because I don't worry when my kids are traveling mm-hmm. or when they're doing something dangerous.
Yeah.
And if I thought for 1 minute that worrying about it would keep you from being harmed, then I would think that's a great thing to do. But instead, I actually believe that what we think affects what happens. I don't think, you know, worrying about somebody makes something bad happen to them, but it certainly puts it out in the universe that I don't have faith in your ability to stay well, or the universe, I don't have faith in the circumstances to take care of you. So I don't worry about that. And I never worry about myself, like, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? Or, oh, I can't do that because I might get hurt, or I can't do that because of, you know, whatever the reasons are. That really doesn't. But for the most part, I just don't.
Okay. Well, I got a couple of stories. One is that I use this classic example of when I was late to work and I was on the subway, and you can't do anything once you're on the subway. All you can do is wait. And I was still worrying about being late to work. And that type of worrying is totally futile. I just realized futile is attached to the word utility. It is lacking in utility.
It's futility.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah.
But then the other one is the studio, for example. Like, I was seeing the writing on the wall for months, and I was like, this ship is sinking. And you just were not worried about it. And I was like, I'm very worried about it. But we didn't do anything about it. And that was not a good thing to not do anything about it.
No, it wasn't.
So there's certain times where worrying is helpful.
It'll
get you to do something. And there's other times where it's just like, this is not useful anymore.
Yeah, chronic worrying, I don't care what the circumstances, chronic worrying is not helpful. If you worry about something and then take some action, like, oh, I'm worried that my kids are going to get killed in a car accident, so I'm going to teach them to use their seatbelts, keep their cars in good shape, and learn how to drive well, that's a whole different thing. But if I just worry all the time that every time my kids get in a car that they're going to wreck, then that's not good. So the studio, we did not, we, well, I... I used my, you know, my positivity. I know this is going to work out. I know it's going to work out without changing my behavior. And you know, God helps those that help themselves. The universe helps those that help themselves. I didn't see the writing on the wall the way that you did. And we've taken steps and things have gotten better. Then they kind of vacillate. But I think we worry in cycles. Like you and me, you and I.
We do have a strange
we worry
ebb and flow
and then
to
we
that.
Get this flurry of activity and positivity and we get a bunch done and people start coming in and then we go, okay, we've done it.
Well,
and
I think the problem is that when you work as a team, it's really important. Is that chimney painted?
Hold on a second.
That's not brick. That's just painted.
No, it's painted over brick, I think. Or it's painted. I have no idea.
Sorry, it's a digression. If you're not watching the video, we're outside, and I was looking at the chimney on our roof.
I've never looked at it before.
I haven't either. There's also a stick.
We did not worry about that chimney until this moment.
When you work as a group and you've got teammates, it's really hard to keep the motivation. So when you work by yourself, there's no problem with motivation. You're either going to motivate yourself or you're either going to do something or you're not going to do something. Do something. So like for the vlog, for instance, I'm the only person working on the vlog. The vlog gets done every day. If I don't want to do it, I don't do it. If I do it, I do it. But like Adventure Archives, for example, there's a bunch of people that work on it. So like when my motivation kind of wanes, is it wane?
Yeah.
Yeah, and then if nobody else's motivation waxes, then it just wanes. Or like if somebody else's motivation wanes and I don't fill in the gaps and wax, then...
Yeah, no, I think that's true. And I think that probably happens at the studio as well. Or in anything. You know, it's obviously our podcast has three main things. Archives, studio, and the dishes. Our lives revolve around those three things.
Well, it's true.
It is true. It is true.
That's what I spend the most time doing.
Yeah. Well, and the other things that are important to us seem to go pretty smoothly, like food. Like we are both motivated all the time to figure out the best way to eat to make ourselves feel good. One of us is generally always trying to make sure that there's food there. And when there's not, we suffer, but that remotivates us. That suffering does. The other things, the group dynamics is pretty difficult for us to keep on a constant upward. And adding a little worry to it might help on parts of it, at least on my end, because I don't worry enough. I'm not a defeatist, but I am an acceptist.
Well, that's the interesting thing, right? Because it's like that old, it's not old, but it's like that Neil Donald Walsh thing. He says, if you're trying to go to Seattle and you're heading towards San Jose, it's not a right or wrong thing. It's just like you're going the wrong way. So like if you want something, like let's take the studio, for example. If you like teaching classes and you would like those classes to continue, you have to find a way to motivate or worry yourself about the other details.
Yeah. I think that's exactly right. And you put it kind of in those terms the other day. Basically, that if you still have the passion and you really want it to go, then you gotta take over. And we've been saying that for a long time, but it kind of has clicked with me. Like today when I went back to the studio after my classes, I looked at all the myriad of things that I could do. And the two that were the most likely to help us bring more people in so I can continue to do what I have a great passion to do were two marketing things. I went there to clean the studio. But cleaning the studio is not going to get any more people in, and I can clean the studio tomorrow afternoon. But today, I contacted the Groupon lady, and I developed an email list of people that I want to, who have been to the studio but didn't join, that I can try to reach out to. I don't know that that's going to, it'll stick, but somebody pointed out to me last night that, you know, at this point, whatever you do, you know, why not try everything? No.
Well,
no
I
more
guess
worrying.
We should just some real quick background for the people who have no idea what we're talking about.
Okay.
We run our studio. We teach dance classes.
Studio. Yeah.
And it makes enough money to pay the bills. It does not make enough money to make anybody who runs the business, which is us, any money.
Yeah.
So when
it started, we both had a great passion for dancing, for getting people to move, to encouraging people to accept their bodies the way they are while they're trying to reach goals to change their bodies, if that's what their goal is. And as time has gone on, the business part of it has really drained some of that passion.
Yeah.
For you especially.
Yeah.
For me, no. I still get teary-eyed when I think of the possibility that I might not be able to go there tomorrow and teach that. And I still get so much inspiration and so much joy out of every class that I teach, every single one, every private student that I meet with, everybody that I do that. But we still have to make a living. You know, it eventually you get tired of doing other jobs to make this thing work, instead of trying to figure out a way to make this make our living. So for us, worrying about it dying shouldn't even be a consideration anymore. There's no point in us worrying about it going away. That's a big possibility that at some date in the future that our business might not make it. We've made it longer than most small businesses do already. So why not stop worrying about it? Stop worrying about any of the reasons why we didn't try some things and do those. Like, a lot of the things that we've thought about doing, we like, well, that's not fair to our current students, those promotions, because they joined full price. Mm-hmm. You know, we can't do this, we can't do that. Well, at this point, if we lose people and we get 10 more instead, from a business perspective, that makes more sense.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because I've had this conversation with you before, but like with my previous girlfriends, I had a big problem with just saying what was really on my mind.
Mm-hmm.
And it was funny because like the relationship would get so bad, and then you said to me before, you're like, well, why don't you just say exactly what's on your mind? You got nothing else to lose at this point. And yet for some reason I still couldn't do it. But that's the truth though. What you're talking about, the business is like, at this point there is like literally nothing to lose. You can try anything. So I think it just takes somebody actually trying something.
Yeah, which is what I decided to do. We'll see next week when we do the podcast if I've stuck with that. Yeah. But I still believe that many of the things that we've talked about before about the happy ending being assured.
Mm-hmm.
That,
well, okay, that's
these, they're two competing concepts.
I don't think they are, because the happy ending being assured is not a specific outcome. So yes, I do believe the happy ending is assured, but that does not mean that the studio is going to survive based on that belief. If you want something to happen, sometimes you have to just, you gotta try pretty hard at it. And then of course you have to be unmarried to the outcome. So you can't be like, I gotta have this specific outcome.
Yeah.
Because you know, just a lot of people will try to tell you can have whatever you want, you can get whatever you want. Maybe, maybe not. But in my experience, that is a recipe for unhappiness, is to believe that you can have anything you want. The only recipe for happiness that I found is that you just decide to be happy right now and then don't worry about the circumstances and everything else.
Yeah.
But you got to do what you can do to make things happen.
Yes.
And you got to go as far as you can go. Because like for me, like if we're being completely honest with the studio, I have given up.
Oh, I know.
I'm like,
yeah, which is one of the reasons why I have been trying to get it to where you're there less often than me, because I still, I have not given up.
Mm-hmm.
And without you to lean on, it makes me have to use brute force a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
To remind myself that if it is going to happen, which I want it to, but my happiness is not dependent on it happening, but if it's going to, it's going to be me that's going to do it. And maybe it'll be in some other form that it's in right now. Maybe we move to a less expensive place. Maybe we, there are lots of options.
I think that would be.
Yeah, that's a really good option, by the way. And our lease is not that much longer. So that's an idea out there. But the idea that you have to believe that something will happen.
Uh-huh.
If I believe that it won't happen, I'm not going to pursue it.
That's true. Yeah, you told that story before. Yeah. They're like, well, that's never going to work. He's like, okay, well, then I'm going to stop. I'm not even going to bother.
If I'm positive that it won't work, then I'm definitely not going to expend any energy on it. If, however, I believe there's a possibility that something will work, then I decide to be happy while I'm working on it without my happiness depending on it working.
Yeah.
That's the big difference.
Well, I think just any type of happiness that depends on anything else but your own consciousness, like literally that basic and that fundamental. If any of your definition of happiness depends on anything
other than just choosing it.
Yeah, anything other than just like I'm alive right now. Like that specific part of your experience, if it relies on anything else, it's going to end in suffering. Guaranteed, every time.
Well, I wouldn't go that far. I think it's just chance whether you'll actually be happy or not.
Well, I mean, if suffering is going to show up in some form in your life, guaranteed.
Yeah. Well, yeah. We have the only thing that we have control over is our consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
And frankly, I believe that we don't even have control over that unless
we're
well-nourished.
We don't have control over thinking.
Yeah. Until we're nourished well, we're rested well, and assuming we've not had any trauma, that's when you can think or not think. You can make good choices. You can decide to be happy. If you're malnourished or not rested, it's very difficult to muster that happiness. Although, I will just say, I'm not a special person, but I can feel pretty crappy and still be really happy.
Well,
just because I am happy to be alive.
Yeah.
And while I have goals, I want things that I want to accomplish. I mean, even now, when I think about the studio, if Revel Fitness a year from now doesn't exist, I don't cry anymore. like I know how I feel when I'm teaching people about their bodies, and when I'm teaching people about how to take care of it, how to nourish it, how to move it, how to get joy from moving your body. I don't need Revel Fitness to do that.
Mm-hmm.
That's the realization that I've come to. So that goal, I can put all my effort into it, knowing that, you know, we've got low expectations, high
commitment.
Thank you. That's the position that I'm in. But regardless of how it turns out, I can decide at every moment that I'm happy. I'm alive. I got air to breathe. I'm not hungry. My basic needs are taken care of. For the most part, I eat really well. You know, I have no reason to be unhappy, and every ability to choose to be happy.
I think that's the thing with worry, is that you don't need to worry about it. Like, whatever it is, because it's okay. You were dead before you were alive. So anything above that is actually a bonus, even if it's not good.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's just like, there's difficulties. But they're only difficulties in the sense that you're not going to get exactly what you want. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, if you're still alive, then it's not such a big deal.
Yeah.
You know, you don't have to worry about it. Let me tell you about one form of worry that is not helpful, and that's worrying about what you've already done. So
that's
like,
called regret.
Yeah. So like with the studio, I could list 10 things right now that would have helped immensely had we done them. But it's too late. Or had we not done. Like, there's so many things you could look back in hindsight and be like, oh, I wish I had done that. And you just worry about,
yeah,
why didn't I do that? And
well, let me pop in there, because that's, I can't remember now what the term in logical analysis is. It's like you cannot go back and say, if A had happened, something that didn't happen did happen, then X would have happened. We don't know that. Maybe it would have had a better chance. Maybe it would have led to some other problem. Maybe it would have led to some great success. Maybe it would have turned into, you know, who knows what. Same way with, if you had not done X, then Y would have happened. No, you don't know that. It's easy to say that. It's easy to look back and go, oh man, if we had just gone to memberships when we first started, how great we would be. We may never have gotten off the ground. We may not, we had nothing, we had no name recognition. We had one thing, Zumba.
No, it's just like, the one I was thinking of specifically was, we could have added more classes and not moved to a bigger studio.
That's, I'm not sure that's accurate.
Yeah, no, there it might not be accurate.
It's not accurate. There are certain times of the day when people will come and exercise. Yeah, we could have had a class every hour of the day. It would not have solved the problem that we had.
That's true.
Yeah. So anyway, but worrying, let's get back to where we're at. So worrying is a good tool. It's a short-term tool. If a worry doesn't pop into your head at all, if you have, worrying is a form of awareness. If you don't have an awareness of a problem or an opportunity, if you're not aware of it, you will do nothing about it. So it's a good thing. It's that constant loop of worry about something, like or a kind of worry that prevents action. Like I know people that won't travel because they're afraid they're going to get killed in a crash or someone's going to rob them while they're away from their home, who basically stop living because of their fear. And that kind of worry, that loop that paralyzes you, is never good. It's just the worry that's a slight awareness is there long enough to spur some action, in my opinion.
I think you're pretty much right on the bullseye. We're going to take a quick break, and we will be right back instantaneously. So what's the takeaway? Is the takeaway, because this is actually something I've been thinking about a lot lately, just because my big goal in life right now is to get all the shit out of the way. Okay, excuse my language, but I just want to get everything out of the way that is in the way of me doing the things I want to do. And I feel like that is kind of I feel like it's a good thing to do. Like, I'm tired of things being in my way of the things that I want to do. It's kind of like with school. When I was in school, I was like, I hate school. Why am I still in school? I don't understand why I'm still in school. And then when I finally graduated, I was like, thank God that's out of the way. Like, I just don't like it. And I will never go back to school for that exact reason. It's just such a, whatever benefits I got out of it, it was so overweighed by my daily experience being so bad. Whether that was my fault or not, that's the reality of that situation, is that it was so overwhelming how much I hated it that it didn't allow me to enjoy the other parts of my life. So in the same way, like, I can have problems in my life, but I don't want them to worry me. So my current tack is to get rid of things that are going to worry me rather than worrying about not worrying. Does that make sense?
Sort of. If I understand that your goal is to simplify your life to such an extent that the chances of having things to be chronically worried about are gone.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a worthy goal. And an accomplishable goal, because the things that will come up that you will need to worry about, become aware of, and do something about will be fewer and farther between, as opposed to having things that are just constantly there, especially if there's something that you can eliminate. Like for you, it's the studio. You still seem to like teaching your class when you feel well. And you don't mind going open and close. But anything else about it, I think you're done with.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's an okay thing. That's something that you can, it's like switching any job. You know, you don't like this job or it's no longer fulfilling. You stop that and find something that you do like. Or you find something and then stop that. You can, you know,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Whatever your monetary situation is. So I think that's a good thing to do. To be a minimalist, which you are doing, gives you a lot of freedom because you don't get bound up by your stuff.
Mm-hmm.
If you have, like for me, constantly doing laundry or needing to do laundry. But I can go a long time without doing it because I have a lot of clothes. but when I run out, then I have no choice, and it doesn't always coincide with when I have time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So for you, it's just, you know, I've got this. I'm going to have to do my laundry in, you know, this week. I'm going to have to do it today so that I'll have it's just a part of your routine. So I don't think there's anything wrong with eliminating things that you don't enjoy and that don't have to be in your life.
Mm-hmm.
If your goal instead, though, is to eliminate all these things in your life so you will never have problems, that's delusional.
Yeah, that's definitely delusional.
definitely delusional. And we both know people that is their way of dealing with the world, is to try to prevent every problem by not doing anything or not letting the people around you do anything so that they don't encounter problems. You know, do it my way, do it the way I said, and then I don't have to worry about you having any problems. That doesn't work. It just deprives them of life and the people around them from enjoying them in life in the fullest way that they could. You could still enjoy them, but part of what you would have shared or believe you have to offer for a sharing opportunity doesn't exist because of it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's a really good goal. I kind of like it myself. I've liked it since, you know, the various things that I've pared down, just because you've modeled it and making my choices based on what I want to do, not about what I'm afraid is going to happen if I do what I want to do. That's a really good way to do things, I think.
Well, I was just thinking is, like, I know people who every single day there's a new catastrophe. Every single day something is, like, there's something so dramatic. And I think that type of worry is almost like it exists. It makes you exist to fulfill it. Does that make sense?
Yeah. That kind of drama. And I think that's just a function of attention. I really do.
I mean, the person wants attention?
No. I think it's the attention they give to stuff.
Oh. Got it.
Like we all have problems going on in our lives. But they don't have to be, they don't always need to be expressed.
Right.
Instead, you can go ahead, just deal with that problem and move on. But a lot of people need that ability to share that, to make, I think it all goes back to what we've said from the very first podcast. It's to make a connection with other people.
Yeah.
I don't trust the good things that have happened in my life to share that with you. I don't even see them because all I pay attention to is the problems that are in my life, but I still want to connect with you. So I want to complain about them. I want to tell you about them.
Yeah.
I don't want you to tell me how to solve it. I just want to make a connection with a human being. And that's the level at which they can make that connection at this point in their life.
I think you nailed it. What I've been trying to do lately is, like, you know, I like to talk and think and come up with theories and such. And then lately what I've been doing is, instead of, like, talking about what I think's wrong with society or what's wrong with me or what's wrong with somebody else, lately I've just been like, I don't say anything.
I got that.
And I'm just like, well, okay, yeah. Whatever.
Yeah. Like, yeah, and well,
that kind of goes.
Yeah, especially since those are just theories.
Yeah, just theories. Yeah,
they're just theories.
And
you have no idea what it really is.
It's true, though. Really, what you said, though, is that they just want to make a connection with another person. Because when I say those things, like, it's not actually that big of a deal. Or, like, the theories I come up with, they're not always that profound. I just like talking.
Yeah.
and I like talking with somebody who's going to listen.
Exactly. When there's a dialogue where you say something and I actually understand it. It clicks something, and I respond in a way that shows I've gotten that and that you've inspired me to. That's why, you know, they say 2 brains are better than 1. 10 brains are better than 1 if you're communicating. But if you're talking and you say, oh, I went to the park today. I saw this beautiful blue bird. And I say, my bathtub's stopped up.
That sounds ridiculous, but that's not too far off.
It's not too far off.
I'm going to say, oh, okay, yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
Can you believe what happened to my bathroom today? Okay.
Yes. Okay, so that is the kind of the kind of connection that we're all trying to make is the kind where it's like in that Avatar movie when they say I see you. Mm-hmm. That has a real meaning. Mm-hmm. Like I see that you're a person. I see that you have thoughts and feelings and I really want to know what they are. But in return, I want you to know and see me. So when you have someone who, like, complains constantly, like, today it's the next thing. Maybe they're related, maybe they're not. But when that happens repeatedly, at some point, you really want to, like, shake them and go, okay, what happened that was good in your life? Share something good. I will listen to you just as intently. It's still you have to understand, or I do. I'm going to say for those people who have not heard our podcast, we say you need to do this, you need to do that. When we say that, we mean us. We need to do that. That I need to remember that what they're trying to do here is connect with me. And take that as a compliment that they want me in their life. They want to make a connection with me. And I want to make a connection with them.
Or maybe you don't.
Or maybe I don't. But I can make that choice constantly instead of coming back to talk to you or somebody who I do make a connection with and go, can you believe they complained again? Which I've done many times. And then as soon as I say it, it hits me. You know, it's kind of what you said last week about connecting with them on the level that you at your common place. And sometimes you don't have a common place. You don't have to make a connection with every person that's deep. Maybe it is as much as saying, you know, isn't it beautiful out today? And taking a moment to jointly acknowledge this beautiful, gorgeous weather and the buds and, you know, the birds singing in the back.
Yeah. I think one of the things I've been thinking about lately is, like, what if everything's just fine and it's okay?
It is fine.
It is, for sure. But I mean, what if you just stopped talking about anything except for something that's actually interesting? You know what I mean? Like, instead of being like, oh man, if only we had this, if only this was like this, if only this and that. Instead, just like, oh, okay, this is enough right now. I don't even actually need to say anything. This moment is enough.
Okay, this podcast is over. I'm just kidding.
Well, actually, that's kind of the point, too.
It kind of is the point. Everything is fine. It is fun to discuss and have dialogue, but there isn't any need for it.
Yeah.
No?
It seems kind of weird because it's almost like you're going back to where you started. You come out of the womb, and immediately, boom, you're like, oh, man, I'm not good enough of this, like, blah, blah, blah. And you're always, like, wanting, needing, striving, yearning. But then you can come back to the beginning and just be like, oh, wait, just, like, the way it is right now is totally fine. Like, even, like, just, like, take your money problem. Say you owe a bunch of money and you've got no money. Yeah, but you're alive right now.
Yeah.
And you're going to do whatever you can to keep it going. And you might be really frustrated that you don't have any money, but it's still just like, you're fine.
Yeah. Yeah. I've heard people say, well, that's easy for you to say, but if you were living, you know, in abject poverty, then you couldn't be happy. But you watch a child in abject poverty, and of course you don't want that to be happening to them. You want to help. But they can be happy.
Oh, yeah.
They will play no matter what.
Well, my other thing is like, no, you can't tell me what I can be.
Yeah.
I was kind of like John Locke. Don't tell me what I can't do. You don't tell me that I'm not allowed to be happy in any circumstance.
Yep.
Maybe for you. But like, it's funny, but like, I've really internalized that just lately. It's just, no, you can't tell me that I'm not happy with what I've got right now. You can't tell me that I need this, this, that, or the other.
Yeah.
No, I don't.
Yeah, it's it's good to let your body metabolize that and really have it be part of you. Because, like for me, there was a time when, well, let's go back to worrying. I have literally been told by people who love me or people who barely know me that it's only a bad mother would not worry about their children when they're away from them. And I can honestly say, I don't.
Well, it's kind of insulting. It's like, Mom, I'm 30 years old.
No, but even when you were...
Am I 30? Am I 31? I'm 31.
31. Yeah, you'll be 32 this year.
Yeah.
But I also... I don't worry about my grandchildren. When Sanjay and Diane take the kids and they go on vacations and stuff or whatever they do, they're going to be in the car driving. It does not occur to me for a minute, oh my God, I hope they don't have a wreck. I can't wait till I hear until they get home that they didn't have a wreck. No, that is just so not in my being that I trust they'll be fine. And if they're not, I'll deal with that when that happens. Was like the first time you traveled and went to Indonesia.
Yeah.
And I've probably told this story on there before, but there was an earthquake in Jakarta, like the day you landed or something. and your dad was, understandably, he was concerned. And in my bones, I didn't feel like you were hurt. But even if I had that moment of worry, I went, for God's sakes, for the first time in his life, he's off doing what he wants to do. If he gets killed in an earthquake, then... fine, at least he was doing what he wanted to do. And that got rid of any worry that I might have had. First of all, I couldn't do anything about it anyway. I couldn't get a hold of you. That's all there was to it. So rather than worry myself sick, miss those days of my life worrying about you in a futile attempt to help you, no, it wouldn't have done anything. And I would so much rather you live your life, take the risk that you think you're comfortable with, and perhaps have something bad to you. But bad things are going to happen to you no matter what happens. As you said a while ago, bad things happen. So it isn't in my makeup to be worried about people when they're choosing to do whatever it is that they want to do in their lives.
Mm.
I worry more about the people who are wasting their lives being afraid.
And oh, yeah.
Yeah. Those are the ones that I have some pains in my heart for. I don't have a pain in my heart or a worry when anybody's doing anything that they really have made the decision that that's what they want to do with their life.
Mm-hmm.
It's when they're living their lives with no intention that I have somewhat of a pain, and then I come back to, it's all fine.
Yeah, no.
They got to do it at their own time. No point in me worrying.
Totally fine, yeah.
It's all totally fine. No point in me worrying. If I can share myself with them and that helps them, great. I'm not going to be who I'm not in order to make them feel better. Because first of all, I don't think it will. It won't do any good for me, although occasionally I get frustrated and I do it. To start rattling off all the problems that I have, which I have problems. My life is not perfect.
You got lots of problems. What are you talking about?
Yes.
I don't know who thinks that.
Lots of people do think that I don't have problems because I don't complain very often.
I could list all of your problems. I could tell you how to fix your life.
You probably could. And in our discussions.
No. I mean, yeah. I could tell you what I think, but that's not how you're going to fix your life.
It won't fix my life.
It doesn't need fixing, though.
Yeah,
either.
Exactly. So occasionally I get frustrated and I'll go, you know, they're like, well, you don't understand. You know, you don't have problems. Like, yes, 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 I do. And then as soon as it comes out, I'm like, that really doesn't help me. It doesn't help them either. Although I've had friends say, well, that does help me to know that because I just think you don't have problems because you're always happy. My happiness is my choice.
You know, it's kind of funny because a lot of people are super self-righteous, but they're not self-righteous about their happiness.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, yeah. They're self-righteous about everything except for their happiness. Their happiness is outside of them.
Yeah.
But they're right about everything else. Like, no, you can also be right about your happiness and just be like, yeah, I'm right. Let me give you an example of something I did the other day. The other day, for whatever reason, I was like, I really want some chips, and I want to go to that Indian place and get naan bread. I did both of those things, and I ate.
You had naan?
Yeah, it was good.
Oh, yummy. I was just talking to somebody else about that the other day.
Yeah, and I did both of those things completely, like, unabashedly, unashamed. Yeah. But my problem in the past was always multiple things. Just one is like, oh, if I don't get my life together, when am I going to stop doing the same mistake over and over and over again? Blah, blah, blah. But then which I don't even think it was a mistake. It was just like, whatever. But it's weird because there's that line between that you got to walk of, this is, where do you want to go? Like for me, the other day I went to my cousin's birthday party, your nephew's birthday party. We drank alcohol, and then I drank alcohol the next day too. And then I was just like, I don't feel good. And this is not helping me get to where I want to get in life. And for that reason, the positives of alcohol don't outweigh the negatives. So for me, I'm just like, I don't want to do this.
But you might choose again sometime.
But I might choose again. Yeah,
to do it. And that's, I think that's all you can ask of yourself or other people, is that you make whatever decision you want. No better, do better. No better, don't do better. You know, but don't pretend like you don't know why those things are happening. Like for me, I do a lot of nutritional counseling. I talk to people about how to make their bodies feel good so they can accomplish what they want in life and they can more easily choose to be happy. That's my goal in that part, in that realm of my life. It is okay to continue to eat junk food, stay up late, drink alcohol, you know, do, you know, not sit on the couch and watch Downton Abbey. You know, good God, I would watch Downton Abbey like 24 hours a day if I could figure out a way to like have it just shot into my brain. The same episodes over and over again too. I don't need any more seasons. But it is not okay to go, God, I feel like crap today. I don't know why. Mm-hmm. I don't know why. Yes, you do. You just feel bad. You are regretful for the things you did, or you just want to push it aside and act like it is just a quirk. It's a coincidence. It is a, you know, the chance of life that some mornings you wake up feeling like crap and sometimes you don't. No, that's not it. If you want to feel good every day, I can teach you how to do that. And if you follow that, you will wake up every day feeling really good. You'll be hydrated, you'll be nourished, you'll be rested. And that's what it takes for your body to be good. It's also what it takes for your brain to be good. It is, if you don't feel good, it's not the fairies, you know, giving you a curse. Something's wrong. And it's not that hard to figure out what it is. So it's okay to continue to do that. What is not helpful for you is to be oblivious to that and act like it isn't the case. Like for you, you used to go, you know, I just feel like crap. I don't know why I feel like crap. And then when you started figuring it out, now lots of times you feel like crap, but you know what you did. So if you want to feel better, you know how to fix it. Mm-hmm. Just go fix it. Or continue to feel like crap, but don't complain.
Speaking of which, it's kind of interesting. When you eat a lot of like carbohydrates, bread, sugars, that type of thing, when you wake up in the morning, it is really hard to wake up. Like, it's like you've been drugged.
It is.
Like, and your like limbs are heavy. And
yeah, and everything is, it's almost like everything's clogged.
Uh-huh.
For me,
those things got to have some sort of like drug in them. As good as it tastes and as good as it makes you feel while you're eating them, like it's like morphine or crack or whatever.
I still think it goes back to our primitive brains when we didn't have access to food 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. Like if you got something that was carbohydrate-y and you could ingest it, your brain was designed to go, oh, that's available, eat lots of it, you're hungry for it. That's not that hard to figure out. But if you've got it at ready supply, there's nothing in there to turn that off that says, oh, you know what, we're in the land of plenty.
I like at Chipotle, I could get those chips, I could start eating those from morning until I get sick. And I would definitely, I could easily make myself sick on those.
Yeah.
Just you keep eating them. Keep eating them. And you're like, I'm full. I don't even want to eat anymore. But I'm going to keep eating them.
Yeah. And that's not a lack of character.
Oh, yeah.
That is a biological function.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, that's a really primitive biological function that is not necessary anymore.
Yeah.
And it hasn't been necessary since we've, you know, developed agriculture. And the ability to cook grains so that we could eat them. Like
that,
we,
I think that's the only answer to the, some of the things like that is you have to find something else that's more entertaining than that.
Yep.
Like for me, it's vlogging.
Yeah. For me, it's that I can't start. Like if I start with chips in the morning, I will eat them all day.
Yeah.
If I eat cookies, I'm going to eat them all day. Potatoes, any
it's
of those
amazing
things.
How well not having a food in your house will prevent you from eating that food. Last night, I was so hungry and I wanted to eat. We had no food that was available. And I was like, well, because I'll drink some water and go to sleep.
Well, and the funny part about that is that there was food in the refrigerator. There was a yellow pepper. There was some lettuce. There's some parsley. There was cabbage. There was cauliflower. None of the stuff that your brain was going, I'd really like to have
yeah, yeah,
that.
That's true. Yeah.
And so you were more willing to not eat than to eat the stuff that was available because it wasn't what
actually I found some sardines in the cabinet. I forgot about that.
I wondered where that can went. Oh, that's funny.
Were you looking for it today?
No.
Oh.
No, but it's been in my way where my vitamins are.
Yeah.
I noticed it wasn't
today.
There.
I ate it last night, that is. Okay, I think that does it for today's episode. Do you have any closing thoughts?
Just a reminder to use worry as another form of awareness, that when you start worrying about something, that means you need to do something. Also know that your brain, if you don't do something, is going to keep worrying
about
it.
Well, what if it's something that's not any, what's not even sensical, and it's like an OCD type of worry?
I think doing something is to drop the thought.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, don't forget that just because you have a thought doesn't make it true.
Yeah.
So you can go, oh, well, that was a weird thought that my brain made up. Silly girl, silly boy. Just put that out of your mind. When you know, or if it's something that's a valid worry that you can't do anything about. No, then you have to go, man, I wish I could do something about that. I can't. And move on to something else to use your brain function until that goes away.
I think that's perfectly said.
Okay.
I just died at the end of the podcast. Okay, thank you for listening. We will see you next week.
Yes.
Okay.